What's happening, everybody? This is Michael yet again, and welcome back to the channel. Tonight, I actually have a paid request of a film that came out in 1981, and I'm a little bit embarrassed to admit that I've never seen this film, but I have not. But I've always wanted to watch it, and this request gave me the motivation to finally get my ass in gear and give it a watch. I didn't own the film, so I purchased it. And it's the Shout Factory collector's edition of the film. And of course, it's My Bloody Valentine. And I actually did a poll over on the community page asking which version of the film I should watch, the theatrical release or the uncut release. And overwhelmingly, almost everyone suggested that I watch the unrated cut of the movie. This is a really nice collector's edition of the film, I gotta tell you. Open it up and show you those who don't own this film already from Shout Factory. But I would most certainly say if you plan on getting the film in the future, get this version of the movie. And I'll also say that the special features, there's not a whole lot, but the ones that do show up on this special edition are really substantial. You get to see the cast, many of the cast members, you get to hear their perspective. You get an interview with the director, so you get some really juicy behind-the-scenes information on the movie itself. And to me, you know, there's not very many special features on here, but the ones that are on here are really great. You know, I've given my opinion on quite a few slasher films here lately on the channel, and honestly, a lot of those films are simply terrible. And after watching this film, I've learned that many of those filmmakers could learn quite a bit from this movie. But with that said, one of the things that really early on that stood out in this film is that the characters are really well presented and I would say really well written. Now, there's not a whole lot of development on lots of the characters because there's so many you can't really go into each character's background. But the characters are written in such a way that you can really identify with them and they seem really real. And it's just amazing to me that, you know, some filmmakers get that and some don't. Because, you know, at the end of the day, I gotta say that, you know, I've seen many films where characters die. And a lot of the disappointment for me is that many of those characters, you watch them die and you just don't feel anything. You're just sitting there just, you know, going through the motions. I mean, we're talking about human life here. So at the very least, you should feel something when a character dies in a film. But many films today, you don't feel shit. And as a matter of fact, the characters are oftentimes written so poorly that you're just at a point in the film where you're just like, hurry up and die. I don't give a damn if you die. Just die. But the characters in this movie, surprisingly, were very well done. And even those minor characters that, you know, don't say much, no insight given to the character, they were still very enjoyable. I didn't want them to die. I was just like, oh man, come on, don't kill this character. Or when you knew that a character was gonna meet his or her end, you were just, you know, you're just like, I wanted that character to make it. And that's a feeling that I have not gotten in a very long time watching current slasher films. And granted, I'll say, you know, I'm not the biggest slasher film fan out there. I enjoy the films, but I'm really a novice when it comes to those movies and all that. But My Bloody Valentine, I enjoyed it. I really did. I would say that it was set up very well. The characters are delivered very well. The characters really stand out in this film. The two leads, TJ and Axel. You know, initially, first off, when I started watching this movie, my first feelings were that, you know, are any of these characters going to be likable? And I ended up being pleasantly surprised because the two leads are likable. The female characters are likable. There's no characters in this film that just made me, you know, go, oh my god, this character is so damn annoying, or this character needs to go, please kill this character. I liked many of the characters in this movie, and it goes back to my thoughts on some of the current slasher films in that, you know, I asked the question, do slasher films need good characters, or do you expect the films to have good characters, or do characters matter at all? And, you know, watching this film, characters matter. I've always felt that characters matter. And to me, the reason they matter is that if you're invested in the characters, it just makes the film so much more better. You get past that point to where you're just expecting people to die. You're at a point where you know people are going to die, but you are reluctant to see them die. And this film has that in abundance, because many of these characters, I simply did not want to see them come to harm. You know, I got to say that the 1980s was a great time for motion pictures. Not just slasher movies, but film in general. Absolutely my favorite era for motion pictures. And with that said, you know, I've mentioned that I've never really been a huge slasher movie fan, but I did catch quite a few of them in the theater. The Nightmare on Elm Street films, the Friday the 13th films, the Halloween films, and many other miscellaneous slasher films that came out in that era. It was a great time to be a slasher movie fan. Now, My Bloody Valentine presented us with a new sort of villain, and his name was Harry Warden. Now, I'm a little bit late on the bandwagon, and most of you probably already know his origin, but as far as the story goes, Harry Morgan worked at a mine, and on one fateful day, which happens to be Valentine's Day, he was working that evening along with six other miners. Now, apparently in this town, many of the people celebrated Valentine's Day annually, and two of the supervisors that he worked with wanted to urgently go to this party, in so much that they didn't take adequate safety precautions before they left the mine. There was a methane gas leak and an explosion. Harry and four of his co-workers were trapped underground because of the explosion. And from what I understand, according to the film, they were trapped there for 6 weeks. And the town desperately searched for them. And finally, when they did discover the bodies, there was only one survivor. And I'm sure you can guess who it was. It was Harry Warden. And he'd been there for so long that he had even fed on the flesh of his co-workers to stay alive. Now, as you would imagine, after all the trauma of being trapped in these tunnels, feeding on your co-workers, Warden's mind was really mentally screwed up. And about a year later, he returned on Valentine's Day and killed the two supervisors that he felt were responsible for his suffering and the accident. And he cut out their hearts and placed them into a Valentine's candy box. Suffice it to say, he was captured and he was placed in a mental facility. Fast forward to 20 years later, as I believe the events that I just discussed actually happened in 1960. So 20 years later, it's been quiet, and the town leadership decides that it's time to celebrate Valentine's Day. So they prepare to have a dance, but little do they know, the killing will soon start again with the celebration of Valentine's Day. This town is really into celebrating Valentine's Day. This town, like no other town that I've ever seen, is really into celebrating Valentine's Day. And I don't know how Valentine's Day got to be so important that supervisors of a mining company would actually be in such a hurry to leave that they just, you know, say, fuck it to the employees, fuck the safety procedures, let's just get the fuck out of here. So that's, you know, Valentine's Day, they must have had a real couple of hot dates that they wanted to leave out of there so damn bad. But My Bloody Valentine, you know, I got to say that the premise itself is pretty damn neat. I like the premise. It's a neat premise. I mean, you know, a killer that shows up on Valentine's Day, cuts people's hearts out, puts them in boxes, even puts a lovely little note with the severed hearts. I mean, this guy is just great as a slasher villain. And the whole origin story of how it happened, I mean, you know, oftentimes slasher films are just a little bit over the top, but that's the charm of the movies. I mean, you know, we created a story where a guy, you know, wanted revenge for how he was treated. And I don't know for sure if he just wants revenge because of what happened to him, or he sees it as taking revenge on everyone that died that day. But at any rate, I enjoyed the film. I thought it was really good. And aside from what I've already said about the wonderful characters in this film that you really cared about, you actually gave a damn about the freaking characters. Can you believe it? There's also a decent amount of gore in this film, and I'm a little bit ashamed to admit it, guys, but I guess in my old age, I'm getting a little bit squeamish on gore, because there's many times when characters would suffer their fates in this film, and I was just like, ugh. Come on, man. But some of the gore is really visceral. And I couldn't help but think about, you know, some of the modern slasher films where people would just, you know, talk about the gore and how violent this scene was and all that. But this film had some pretty gory things in it. And I'm to the point now where, you know, there's a behind-the-scenes interview with one of the practical special effects artists, and he's talking about how he doesn't like gory films. He likes films more where it's implied. One of his favorites, he said, was Halloween. He thought that was a brilliant movie. And he said he knew that people loved these kind of films, but he also suspected that there were several people out there that would watch these movies like this and just, you know, be really squeamish. And I think I'm falling into that category, because some of the gore really gets me where I just be, you know, I'm just like, ugh. I mean, there's one scene in particular where a pickaxe goes in a character's face and, you know, the eye pops out. And I'm just like, oh man. And, you know, I can kind of understand some of the censorship that the film was given when it was released due to the violence. And I think initially they gave it an X rating because of the violence, and it had to be edited down to be shown in the theater. But the gore is certainly very visceral and really violent. I would say also that what I liked was the setting itself. And it just goes back to when I said it's kind of a unique slasher film where you have, you know, most of the action or most of the horror taking place in a mine. And a really interesting location for film. It actually just adds a lot of layers, a lot of texture, a lot of realism to the setting. The villain is just really unique, a unique villain. And I'm really amazed that other than a remake, that they didn't make any more sequels after this. But from what I understand, the film wasn't very successful upon its initial release and became a cult classic once it hit home video. But I really enjoyed it. You know, there was a decent amount of tension and suspense when you have these characters in the mines, trapped in the mines, in the dark, this killer running around. And I gotta say, guys, I got a serious alien vibe from this movie. I mean, you had a creature that couldn't be stopped running around the ship. You had darkness. You had suspense. You had tension. I got that kind of vibe from this movie. Now, I'm not saying that this film is anywhere near as great as Alien, but, you know, there were a lot of alien vibes in this to me, where these people were just trapped and they were helpless and trying to fight for their lives. And other than the grittiness of the film and the fact that the mines just added so much realism, I got to say that even the subtleties of the musical score were really good. I mean, you know, there was a time when I would go to the movies and I would just sit in awe listening to some of the beautiful music that was written by some of the composers in the 80s. And oftentimes now when I watch a film, the music is just so generic that I really pay no attention to it. But what I did notice about this film is that the musical score really highlighted the tension and the subtleties of the film, and it worked. I was really impressed with it. Now, there are things that, you know, like in all slasher films that you got to wonder about. Like, you know, at the very beginning, when the miner returns, you see him with this girl, and they're both going off into the mine to have sex. And ultimately, you know that this girl is going to meet her doom. But I kept thinking, you know, this miner, the character doesn't say anything throughout the entire film. All you ever hear is his breathing. And I'm thinking, I wonder what kind of conversation he had with this chick to lure her down in a mine. I mean, who wants to go to a mine to have sex? I don't know. Maybe if she was pretty enough, you'd follow her anywhere. But the way she was rubbing on the miner's costume and, you know, rubbing the holes, his oxygen holes and all this, like it was a penis and all this kind of stuff. It was really kind of suggestive, I would say. Another thing, too, is when our 20-ish cast was in the restaurant, and they were playing the knife game, you know, like Bishop did in Aliens, where he had Bill Paxton's hand on the table and he was just, you know, sticking the knife between the fingers. And in this film, the kids were playing a game like that before Aliens. Is that a thing? Do people actually play that game? I couldn't help but think, my God, dude, that's a dangerous thing to be playing. You could lose a finger. Do people actually play that game? I couldn't see myself playing it. But I just got to say, guys, this was a film that I enjoyed because at the end of the day, when they were in the mines and this guy, this killer was down there, I was really caught up into it. I was into the movie. I was into the characters. I was rooting for the characters. And it's like I said earlier, a lot of modern slasher films, or at least horror films, can learn a lot from this movie in terms of characters, because I think the characters make the movie. You know, this film had a cast of actors who, for the most part, were acting for the very first time. And I don't think the acting is bad at all. I think it's very adequate. This film is not held down by bad acting. And I think everyone did a great job. You know, all the characters, you know, usually in a lot of these films, you have these small town sheriffs or mayors and all that. And they're really kind of annoying, or they're really kind of typical bad characters that, you know, are out to menace the kids in the movies and all that. But the mayor and the sheriff in this film are actually decent characters. I even liked those characters. And as a matter of fact, you know, the chief of police, I was just, you know, hoping that the man would not die. And I got my wish. But, you know, the characters are really great. The location was great. I kind of questioned the idea of actually, you know, someone wanting to go down to a mine during a Valentine party. It's like, wouldn't that be like the last place you'd want to go? But anyway, from what I understand, the director of this movie really despised it for years after he'd made it. And that was due to the fact that the film was cut so badly. A lot of the gore material had been removed due to the MPAA, and he felt like the film was just out of his hands and it wasn't the movie that he wanted to make, and he really hated the film. And then he came to the realization that, you know, many of the other films that he'd done, if he'd asked somebody, you know, what's one of my favorite films, what films do you enjoy that I've made, he said oftentimes people would bring up this film. And he developed an all-new appreciation for this movie, and he said that in the making of material that he really loves the film now, and that's kind of nice. And we've got to thank Shout Factory for this collector's edition of the movie, where they reinserted much of the missing gore shots that were excised from the movie. Now, I have not seen the original cut of the film, but given that I did enjoy this one, I'm really kind of curious to go back and watch and just see how modified it was from the uncut version of the movie. But at any rate, you know, My Bloody Valentine is a really enjoyable film. I would say, you know, if I set it side by side with, say, Friday the 13th and then this film, I would have to say that I probably enjoyed this film more than I enjoyed the original Friday the 13th. This is a really unique slasher film. And I understand that there is a remake, which I've never seen, but I am curious to give it a shot just to see, you know, what avenue they took in making that film. Now, according to the making of material of this movie, the director was asked what he thought about the remake, and he said that he was flattered and honored that they decided to remake his film, but that's about the best thing he could say. So I kind of gathered the impression that he did not care for the remake. But got to say, really enjoyable film. I'm very, very glad that it was requested for review because I enjoyed it. I'm very, very happy to own it. Can't wait to put it with my other Shout Factory collector's editions on the shelf. But enjoyed this movie, and I definitely got to recommend this movie. Now, in closing, what I will say is that apparently, you know, this is kind of a mystery upon who is the killer in this film. You know, which cast member is actually the minor. And I never really took it that way. That whole part of the story went over my head because I was so wrapped up in the story. It never even occurred to me to guess that one of the characters that I was watching was the minor. So I always thought that, you know, the minor was the character that, you know, the prologue spoke of at the earliest part of the movie. I mean, I was kind of thinking, wouldn't he be kind of too old to be doing this killing now? But it never occurred to me that the killer would be one of the characters in the film. And I enjoyed all the characters. And that's what really kind of threw me off, because I enjoyed all the characters. And taken on that level, where you have one of the lead characters as the killer, that's pretty damn interesting too, because it's just something that I never even considered. So it took me by surprise. I was really surprised at the climax when we learn who the minor is. So that was really interesting. I got to say, really interesting, because I wasn't even guessing. I was surprised by the whole thing. So there you have it, everybody. Definitely check out My Bloody Valentine. I think you'll enjoy it if you're into these types of films. I enjoyed it, and definitely happy to have it in the collection. Thanks for your request. I appreciate it. And take care, everyone, and be safe.